Okay, so 3, 2, 1, streaming. It's connecting and go. We're good. That wasn't 5 seconds, but it was fine.
Hey, everybody. Hey, welcome to a new episode of the Venture Maidens podcast. I hope you didn't miss us too much while we recorded our rad bonus episode. But it was pretty groovy.
Sage is with us again.
Yay! Yes, we're indeed. All back together. The original crew.
Although Lizzie was really fun. Not to say, like, Sage, we fucking...
Oh, no. Lizzie was awesome. Great.
Yeah. She's very pleasant. She's a pleasant lady.
Super good balance to Nassim and Mai's just general debauchery.
Oh my.
Just, you know, twinning it up all over the place.
She had good jokes, too. When I was listening to the... I'm kind of slow on the uptake. So, like, or intake? Intake. Whatever. So, like, while I was listening to the episode again, I was, like, kind of listening, and I caught a handful of her jokes. And I was like, she's one of those torpedo jokes. Like, she launches a torpedo, and then it comes silently, and then it...
Bam!
Like,
and just leaves it there.
Yeah, so shout out to Lizzie.
It's more like a... military mines, where you put it there and then you activate it, and then 10 seconds later you're fucked.
But joke, like, detonator.
Immediately you're like,
Yeah, so fuck
wow.
Yeah.
So we haven't played for a little bit, so we're gonna have to recap everybody. But before we do that, intros, of course. Hey everyone, I am your dungeon master, Celeste Conowich.
I'm your Elven Warlock, played by Brittany. Excuse me, Elven Warlock Arnadel, played by Brittany.
I'm the Human Monk Saya, played by Nassim.
And back again is your Dwarven Barbarian Kara, played by myself, Sage.
Yay! We did that so good. All right, let's pull it out of the brain holes, everybody. What happened last time?
So much.
I'm dying.
So much happened last time.
Oh my god, you're like super dying.
Are you dying? You're just on top of the bird.
There were some pretty terrible rolls that happened.
Yeah,
wait, where did I write my damage? Hold on, I think it's in my notebook.
Did you I didn't even realize you took damage.
Yeah.
Let's see. We received our gifts, and then we were told to go to the Sisters of Sorrow Keep and meet Rem. And then we woke up in the van, and then
the cart.
Because
we don't have vans in magical fantasy.
It's
world.
Like a van.
Yeah.
Carts are like a van.
It's one of those white creepy vans.
I imagine it like the Ninja Turtle van or something.
Got a big pizza on the side.
Exactly.
Valerius is super into pizza.
Is he? He does not seem the type to be into pizza. He seems like he's only, on a strict vegan organic
only,
diet.
Only Neapolitana pizza. That's the only kind.
As long as
or I can imagine margarita.
Margarita.
Hey, I like margarita pizza. That's my favorite.
Well, it's the original pizza, so obviously.
It's pizza.
It's kind of a tie between margarita and Hawaiian, to be honest, but... Anyway,
ew, Hawaiian, get out of here.
Not fucking, about that.
I
you
love
goddamn
that,
barbarian.
Dude, sweet and savory is what it's about.
Nope. Don't put that fruit on there.
So,
if it's not tomato, I don't want it.
Arnadel and Aaron finally had their conversation. Well, I don't even know if that really counted. There was a conversation kind of happened.
It was real weird.
I don't know how much was accomplished with that.
It was just real awkward. Everything is always so awkward.
Yeah.
Well, he tried really hard to have that conversation. I think Arnadel was sort of shutting him down a little bit, not to be a slighted NPC or anything.
Was she?
I don't remember it like that.
He apologized, and I was like, hey man, it's cool. Like, don't worry about it. We're working here. Like, it's all good. I thought Arnadel handled that very graciously. And then it got weird.
And then it got
steamy.
As you were inside the igloo.
Yeah, he smelled good.
You guys remember that?
Oh, but before we got to the igloo, we sensed far off in the distance was a rock, a giant bird that was following us and basically circling us. And then so we unhooked a horse from the cart and send it and covered it with shiny shit and send it off into the distance so that the bird would be abused by the shiny things.
Yeah, so we can run away. That was super sad, but that was a brilliant idea.
Of course, Scott got.
Yep.
But then later on, he came back and we had to hide, and thus the igloo. And then all these desert folk came out on their horses and started attacking the bird, and it was because of Arnadel, wasn't it? She started to feel bad and was like, we have to help it, and tried to speak with it.
I felt kind of bad for the bird, but the logic more lied in that, okay, we're literally stuck between a rock and a hard place.
Oh my god, it's like the episode name.
And I was we're probably going to have a much easier time convincing this rock not to kill us than all of these men.
Yeah.
You know, that was the logic. Men.
You made literally no spot checks or search or gather information or anything.
We made perception checks.
I was about to get frenzy out there.
I was about to be like real life situation.
We were looking out into the battle. Igloo.
Yeah.
Let's be honest. Yeah, men so you're tend in to be the a igloo. Lot more threatening than ladies. I'm just saying.
Not in this campaign.
Or I tried to be a weak woman.
We're pretty threatening.
I think y'all are pretty threatening.
Yeah.
As a set. You know, talk to our goblin friend Jerry about that. Oh wait.
Oh yes.
Jerry. He was murdered by you all.
Jerry.
Long live Jerry.
Not a Kara's mouth. Apparently Kara hates goblins.
Because they're gross.
All dwarves hate goblins. It's general lore. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so yeah, you had kind of camped out in the igloo as this battle seemingly like raged before you all, and you saw the fallen rock on the ground had been basically roped in and captured by this band of traveling desert folk. Some of them were mounted on large beast-like wolves. So I think one of you had determined that they were wargs.
No, you accidentally before, slipped so. Up.
Oh, actually, yeah. No. The last accidentally slipped, they were wargs, so now it's cannon. There are wargs. And folks were riding around with them, and they seemed really well prepared for this fight. Like, maybe this was their intention all along to track down this great bird-like beast. So this battle had kind of ensued around this earthen igloo that had been sprung up by your new companion, Valerius. Sort of lukewarmly received, I'm guessing, from you all.
Oh man, we all ganged up on him so hard when he was talking mad shit, and we're like, no, you didn't! Yeah, get out of here, Mr. Fancy Pants!
Yeah, he like kind of shit-talked all of us a little bit, and it was really sweet. We all stuck up for each other.
Yeah, it was great. Really brought us together.
And everyone needs a villain.
Sawyer was a motherfucking wing woman. I have got, like, later, Arnadel's gonna wanna, like, you know, like, elbow tap, fist bump, like, yeah, girl, thanks.
Chest bump.
Right. Yeah, we decided that the fist bump is the elven, yes, the fist bump was the proper elven greeting.
Yeah, an elven greeting. That was well established. That is canonical. To the elven people.
I forgot about that.
Also, apparently, rock, paper, scissors is how the wizard's favorite game.
Yes, and in Dwarven they call it Rochambeau.
I got a message from a listener who was like, how do you not know what Rochambeau is? I was like, no, that was my NPC, but okay. Thanks, dude.
Wait, you just mixed up
episodes.
That's
how good of an actor you are.
You mixed up episodes. Wait, nobody was playing rock, paper, scissors.
Rochambeau to drive the cart?
No, that was while... That was in the bonus episode when your type...
No, it wasn't!
No, it wasn't!
Valerius and I played Rock, Paper, Scissors, and I won, and I got to drive the cart.
For who got to drive the cart?
Oh. Yeah. I just remember...
That happened.
Didn't remember. Sorry.
Anyway, moving swiftly along.
Sorry.
So, Arnadel, you had decided to charge out of the igloo into this fight for whatever reason compelled. You're like, no, I have to do this, and you charged out.
Oh, you were invisible, yeah.
I was like, something came over me. Virgin powers.
And you decided you had to go. So basically the situation was you had seen these 12 individuals who were basically trying to hunt, take down this rock, and based on a general check, you had determined that, I mean, a rock is a really big prize to, like, take down. Like, if you can do that, you are a skilled band of hunters.
Wasn't it 20? I thought it was 20.
Maybe it was 20. I think now we're down to 12.
Oh, okay.
Well, yeah, after shenanigans.
That's
sorry.
Fine with me. That is all right.
If it's Cara 12, marked a few.
Yeah.
Yeah, so basically, these 20 riders had been going in there, and so they had had about 6 of these giant wargs between them, and you remember they had had the spear holders who were on, like, the front end, and then they had had folks who were running around with ropes to basically bind this gigantic avian beast as they were going. So it was a skilled operation that they were kind of running. And you had looked out onto this, and you're like, yeah, and decided you tried to make your way through the big circle of the wargs that were running around, of the spear holders that were running around, and the rope circle that had moved through. So you basically cut a path, and Aaron had jumped in there with you, also helping to slash ropes with his daggers as he was moving through. So you guys were basically destroying that. Sawyer, you had tried to jump up and over to actually, like, land onto the bird through the midst of the action. And Kara, you had run in with the best of your ability going, well, motherfucker's gonna get fucked. And you're like, pow, pow, pow. I remember you killed at least 3 of the footmen as you were slinging through. And a bunch of them now totally unprepared for this assault. Like, the whole plan has kind of fallen apart. The rope structure and the net they had woven is just in pieces now. So you were all standing amidst this huge scene of chaos. Oh, wait. Sawyer, didn't you ride in with the horse with Valerius?
And almost squished Arnadel?
Yes, but Arnadel had used her sort of new gift. Yeah, do you guys want to talk about your gifts again for the audience that were bestowed to you?
I have future vision, and yes, I made Steven Universe references because I fucking love that cartoon. Oh my god.
I love that show so much.
Good. It's so good. And Garnet's amazing. So yeah, I have future vision.
She's immensely, my favorite.
Immensely proud of that.
And basically what that allows you to do is force a reroll that was made against you.
Yes.
So either like an attack or something ill that happens that has to roll against you or damage, you could force a reroll.
Attack and damage?
Yes. Or damage.
That's pretty sweet.
You can force your DM, mediator of fate, to reroll anything.
That's cool. Would that also be for an ability check against me?
Yes.
Oh, fuck, that's so sick. Oh my god.
Yeah. And then Nassim, your the gift of the present, as it was fondly
my gift of the present.
Not redundant
is,
at all.
The ability to briefly stop time, so really re-rolling something that I do, right?
So basically, the way it works, it's like, it's not you so much stopping time as you move faster than everything else. So you get to grant yourself an additional 6-second round at any point.
Mm-hmm.
So you can insert that to take another action, like in a round cycle, or like you could add that on top of what you already have. Basically, not so much that you stop time, but you perceive time as it is and move faster than everything else.
You're like Quicksilver from the X-Men.
Yeah. It's not keeping up with me.
Right.
Yeah. Wait, remind us, though. Is that something that we can do once a day?
Once a day.
Okay.
Though in 5e, it sort of translates to once per long rest, but I won't be a stickler. I'll go long rest.
That's cool. By the way, that scene in the X-Men with Quicksilver, when you first meet, like, that scene is so fucking gorgeous. Uh-huh. It's so pretty.
Alright, and Sage?
Mine is the gift of the past, is that if I, like, oh shit, I just rolled a one, once per long rest I can choose to re-roll that. Mm-hmm. Hit the oh shit button.
Yeah. And you can choose to re-roll on a check or on damage.
Cool.
If you wish. So kind of the opposite of Brittany's ability. Yeah. She can force a re-roll while you can control one of your own.
Could you imagine if we all used our gifts, like, at the same time?
The universe would
explode.
It's like putting a bag of holding inside a bag of holding. Like, you just
Or putting a portable hole.
Just create a tear in space.
Yeah.
You're putting a portable hole in a bag of holding.
Yeah.
So, that's just before I tried to leap onto the rock itself.
Yeah.
And
so
in traditional monk fashion, failed miserably.
In traditional Saye fashion. I would say monks are usually pretty good at this stuff. Do you have a new dice, Gur?
Well,
sounds like you need one.
Well, this one's treating me well tonight, so that's the one I'm going with.
Alright. So I believe, Saye and Arnadel, you've already used your gifts. I don't believe Kara has yet.
No, I haven't.
Okay. Alright. So let's dive in. Situation, because things got pretty crazy. The last moment that had happened, Arnadel, you had made your way over to the Great Beast, and the majority of the ropes on its right side, so its right wing, had been cut, so it was able to leverage its wing sort of free, and you had spoken to it using diplomacy, animal handling, your mental telepathy, and basically conveyed, hey, we're here to help you. Mm-hmm. And the bird seemed to recognize that and looked towards you for a moment, stopped its struggle, and then made a renewed effort as, with the leverage now given to its right wing, it had ripped the cords free from its left. So now this great beast is basically unlocked, and all the riders and the men around who are still, like, alive and also, like, just are thrown in complete disarray as this just amount of action has happened so quickly, and they're not even really sure what's going on. So, general situation. I'm going to have you all roll initiative again for me.
Okay.
Now that we have a new NPC in the mix.
I rolled
18.
I rolled a 15, but I don't remember what my dex is. Stand by. Ooh. I rolled a 19.
I rolled a 6. Oh, and also, we should take note of how awesome my shirt is.
Oh, wow.
It's pushing and biting a dragon.
That's pretty cute. As it's
so good.
In its Unicus form. Or Alicorn.
Yes. Unikitty.
A Pegasus.
Sorry, Saya, you got a what?
18.
Hilarious. And then Aaron. Oh, so many NPCs, you guys.
All right, be right back real quick.
Yep.
I'm on the rock. Oh, man, this is so much, kids. Well, the rock on a natural one.
Woo.
That's fantastic. All right. So it's looking like a... Oh, my God. My desk is, like, real estate minimized right now, so forgive me.
Sage, I'd be a Jedi too.
Oh, this is Paul's, but like for real, like real talk though, I would totally be a Sith.
I would Jedi. No, I am all about the Jedi.
Jedis are
you can't have sex as a Jedi.
I would
F
be a gray Jedi.
They have relationships.
No, they can't.
They had relationships.
They literally can't.
You guys clearly didn't watch Clone Wars. Obi-Wan totally has a steamy relationship with another character, and
that
it is bittersweet.
That was That was before he was a Jedi.
What age did they become Padawans? Nah, they had a thing. You're a Padawan
before. They did have a thing.
They had a fucking thing, and like...
They did. It was, that tension is steamy.
Dude, it was. And it was so sad, I cried. I totally cried. Anyway.
I don't know what you're talking about, but I want the cool armor and the red crystals to upgrade my sabers, so, you know, what else? Totally a
Jedi
Sith.
Jedi all the way.
Hashtag Sith.
Jedi.
Hashtag Sith team. Dark side. Okay. Anyway, so a general description before we sort of dive into everything. Fortunately, we're not on Roll 20 anymore, so I can't give you guys, like, comfy maps. But imagine this whole battle as a large three-tiered circle right now. So the rock itself is huge. It's a huge creature, so it's taking up a gigantic amount of space in the center of the circle. And so on that center ring right now, Saye, you have jumped, kind of fallen onto the back of this thing. So you're sitting in between. It's like you're actually on the left wing. So right now, if this thing were to take off, you'd be in a pretty precarious position. Just letting you know straight away. You ungracefully fell onto the back of this thing. And then, like, the second ring, you would have the moving footmen. So right now, as you're looking at that, there are still four of these individuals. So recall again that they were dressed in that kind of desert traveler garb. So totally in, like, white linens, just completely adorned. They have the capes, everything, like the big packs, and they're holding long spears. So these are like the 10-foot spears that they were using to manipulate the ropes that were being wrapped around. So if you want to imagine this like a, you know, basic chemistry atom, that'd be a good way to think about this fight right now. So there are six of them on that middle ring. And then on the very outside ring, Kara, you disturbed a lot of these, and then also the horse running through a few of the riders. So some of the throne riders have actually moved into the mid-tier. But right now you have two of these giant wargs moving around that are still bearing riders. And they're, like, on the outermost tier, so that's where Kara is. And, Arnadelle, you're sort of drifting in between the two middle pieces, standing next to Aaron.
Okay.
And then, the rest of the wargs at this point have just gone running off because either the riders have been dislodged, or the riders seem to have given up, or the beasts are just sort of taking back the situation because they're scared as hell right now.
Mayhem.
So you're looking at six footmen, two wargs, and then two riders on top of the wargs. So you're facing 10 folks right now. And again, to reiterate, you haven't made direct checks or perceptions to perceive more information about what these writers actually look like.
Am I up first in initiative?
Okay.
You are indeed.
Well, let me go ahead and take a motherfucking hint and roll a perception check.
Hey!
Or, I guess... you know what? I'm gonna do investigate.
So I would call this perception versus investigation.
Doesn't matter. I rolled a one.
Okay.
But I'm
there
gonna,
is
you know what?
So much going on right now. You just talked to this bird, and it looked you deep in the eyes, and you're like, "Oh my god!" Like, yeah. Bird gods are real, and you saw its soul, and it saw yours, and like,
can't. Would it? Yeah. Maybe make me question whether or not I liked birds or snakes? Anyway, so I'm gonna go and cast,
Aren't they more genetically similar than mammals? Anyway.
Reptiles? And birds?
Reptiles and avians?
No. Not that I'm aware of. I don't think so.
Anyway.
The whole, like, warm blood, cold thing, and... Anyway.
They lay eggs.
There's
a mammal that lays an egg. Like to cast... I want to know how Shatter works. Have I ever... Yes, I have cast Shatter, haven't I?
Yes.
No, fuck it. I'm going to cast Witch Bolt on the closest motherfucker by me.
Okay. So closest right now to you are the footmen and the inner ring.
Okay.
So if you want to go ahead and, like, shoot at one of them...
Yes.
Totally. I am going to give you disadvantage on this because of how distracted you were during your perception.
Damn.
So, like, you're so overwhelmed by everything, you're even having a hard time getting purchase on any of the folks around you. And, like, don't forget, you're in the salt flat, so everything is hot and glistening and, like, shining weird. And
that's intense. Do I have to cat? I mean, okay, so I need to roll to hit. But disadvantage.
Yes. Okay. You're rolling two die.
I get to add my spell attack bonus, right? So that's going to be... What's 7 plus 8? 15?
Yes.
Yep.
Roll 15. My first roll was a 19.
With disadvantage?
Yeah, my first roll was a 19.
Damn.
And my second roll was a 7. Really?
Nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
Mofo.
So, yeah, this beam of cackling blue energy lances out toward this dude or person, because you haven't specified if they're male or female.
It's very hard to tell without further perception.
Okay.
Even what race they are. They're all varying sizes and shapes from a cursory glance.
So
you may not even assume that they're all human.
Gotcha. So I'm going to roll my d12, which is ridiculous, for damage. Damn. I rolled a 1. What the fuck is up with this? One damage.
Thought.
But Witch Bolt, you get to maintain every round as long as you concentrate, so... You don't have to roll the hit again.
Right.
All right, so you shoot off, and, like, you're kind of watching, like, the spinning motion of this ring of folks moving around you, and they're trying to maintain form, but also there's so much going on that they're kind of running all over the place, and the heat and the salt, and your eyes are burning, and it's so hard, and just kind of throw magic right out at this shell, hoping to hit a target. And you manage to find purchase on one of these individuals, and they're just like, as it happens, and the spear sort of recedes, and they're all, like, going back to this defensive position, as opposed to that hunter stance, clearly waiting for someone to give them some kind of instruction.
I feel like with a 1 damage, that's more of like a, ow, that hurt.
I mean, I think it'd be scary if a bolt of, you know, purple... blue electricity came hurling at you, even if it didn't so much. It feels like a really bad shock.
Okay.
Like, if you unplug something and you're like, oh, God, then you feel weird for a bit. All right.
Oh, it stays with you.
Yeah, it just, like, you know, the whole thing resonates. It is your turn. So you are on the back of this creature. And you can feel, after its interaction with Arnadel, it is kind of shifting and moving, and so it had burst its left wing, like, out of its confines. So the beast, you can actually feel its musculature underneath you. It's, like, kind of stretching and testing just to make sure that everything's okay. So it feels like action is soon to come with the great beast, and you're sort of, like, rippling on top of it. At this moment, like, oh shit.
Does it feel like it's gonna take off any second, or is it still be down enough? Because if it's got enough ropes on it, I'm gonna try to, like, perception.
It would be an insight or a handle animal to determine what you think it's gonna do next.
Oh, whatever. Animal handling. That is 16.
Okay. You feel like this thing is getting ready for takeoff. Definitely. And, just from, like, kind of cursory information on how rocks work or attack and what you saw before with the horse, the way these creatures usually, like, aid or fight is by flying very high up into the air, making these dive bomb attacks, grabbing a creature, and then they fly real high and drop it, and then get the corpse from there. So it wouldn't be unreasonable to assume, even if this thing was going to help you in the fight, that that might be the tactic it might be about to take. Mm-hmm. So you have very limited time to make a choice whether you want to dive up into the air there or try and jump off.
Boy!
Let's try to jump off. Okay. And glide right down its feathers.
Sure. So an acrobatics or an athletics would be great.
Acrobatics, please.
Indeed.
21.
And she sticks the landing.
All the riders pull out 10 signs, except then they're like, wait, we're fighting. No. So yeah, as you go and you kind of, because you had landed sort of halfway between like the main body and the wing of this beast, so you're actually in a great position to just sort of throw up your arms and roll log style down the wings of this creature as it's like flapping, and every once in a while, you know, they heave upward, so you get a little like 2 foot toss in the air as you're going, but you just keep to the streamline.
Like riding one of those crazy slides at a fair.
Exactly. Yeah, you're like, whoa, the crazy slides, yeah, that are like throwing you around, but you manage to get off to the tip of the wing and kind of gain your footing on the edge there, just as the beast is, yeah, definitely beginning to flap. And now all the dust is forming as this salt is just being pushed off the plains just by the great force of this beast's wings.
Am I near any of them?
Yeah, no, so you use your move action to do that. So now you're on the outside circle where these footmen are. So one of them is actually very close to you, about within 5 feet. And it's sort of like,
I want to try
what the hell? As you just come rolling, like, off of this giant bird.
I want to try to get their attention after I take out this guy.
Okay.
And so we need to run away.
All right. You want to try
so I want to take out...
Roll the hit.
Yeah, just with my quarterstaff, I'm going to go for his nuts.
Lock.
Nice.
Oh. And, ooh. Oh baby, that's an unnatural 20. And
oh baby. We're going to start calling that move an oh baby.
An oh baby. You're lucky.
Or a no baby.
Male NPC, because it's a party mix. Y'all. Percentage-wise, though, you
oh, goddamn.
I'm sorry. That was.
You want to always add my strength on
to. I do a no baby
rolls?
To the woman.
No, that's a no baby. Oh, I mean, either way, no baby.
No, that's a no baby. Yeah. An oh baby is a to the nuts. A no baby is. Never mind. Anyway.
I think either way.
Do I always add my strength mod to my damage roll? Or is it just damage roll?
Yes, okay. You always add it. If you're
then,
using...
Then it's a four. It's
a four. Okay.
Four damage.
So you just... What are you doing? You're clocking them in the...
As soon as I gain my footing and I see this guy who just notices me, I take out my quarterstaff with two hands and just kind of like... Yeah.
You just roll
from,
off
like
a delicate like
below.
Flower, and you're like, not today.
Yeah.
And smack him under
I
the
gracefully head. Stand up and smack him, pushing its dick up into itself. Ooh, just
God, like you're so mean. So you do that.
Tell us how funny it really feels.
Yeah. His eyes cross as the pain of the ages moves through his face. And he falls down, clutching his stomach first, and then, like, drops to the ground as, like, so he's knocked prone.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah. But it's only after, like, 3 seconds after being hit when the pain is fully realized.
I feel like he might even be incapacitated.
He'll never forget me.
He is definitely prone. Not quite incapacitated yet, but he's like, oh, my God. It's like, you monster! Raises a fist and then is like, no, wait, never mind.
Cups haven't been invented yet.
God damn it. All right, and then Kara.
Oh boy.
Let's get out of here.
Start smashing those nuts.
Oh, right, Sawyer, what did you want to yell? Yelling is a free action. Obviously.
Guys, we need to leave the circle!
Okay.
Well, Kara admits her rage. Would probably would not hear you, nor care.
Kara activated her rage last week, so save yourself a rage per day. I think you raged before running into the circle, so yeah. It's still active.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I'm just saying, yeah, I don't think she would have heard Saye admits in full rage mode.
Yeah.
but, okay.
Am I near? I'm not near.
I will make a perception check to see if I hear her and to suss out other enemies nearby and get a good look at them. I got a 12.
Okay. So looking at the general scope of the enemies, the first thing you kind of all noticed is what becomes immediately obvious. They're not all human, all of these riders. It's a large set of, like, assorted heights and sizes, so you're thinking you could probably have everything here from half-orcs to halflings, like, in this band. And because they are wearing the dust masks and the attire that completely almost shields their face except for the section where their eyes are showing, it's really hard for you to specifically determine gender or race, but just based on general sizes, you think that's an accurate estimation. You see now, like, as the disarray that has been caused by your attack, the footmen in the center are holding tight and trying to, like, maintain a line, but they are definitely checking back in. You actually see their heads keep turning back to the two seated riders who are still on the wargs. So you determine that those people are probably leading the charge. That's what your, like, your warrior mind would determine. And these individuals both look about medium humanoid size, though you can't specifically tell what they are. And you see now that they're actually branching a little bit away from the main cluster.
Uh-huh.
So, like, if everything went very poorly, they're sort of getting out of the range.
Yeah, they're gonna get the fuck out.
So that's what you determine with your general perception.
I would like to run towards one of them on the outside.
Okay.
And she's going to put back her battle axe and grab out her, she's going to have a hand axe in each hand, and she's going to fling one at the warg. Yeah.
All right. So, basically, from where you're standing, there's one, like, if you were looking in a circle, there's one about 20 feet away from you on the left side, and there's one, like, a 60-foot shot on the far right side.
All right, I'll go for 20 feet on the left.
Fair enough. All right, you're just throwing your hand axe right into that flank.
Yep.
Let's go.
Boop, 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 doo, doo, doo. I got 17.
That totally hits.
Hell yeah. 4, 8 damage.
Damn.
Oh, 10 damage, because I'm raging.
Oh, that's a lot of damage.
You get plus.
Get out of here, warg. Yeah.
Damn.
Alright. So you see this thing, like, as you move and just aim with true dwarven precision, your hand axe sinking into the hind flanks of this beast. It fells immediately as its right leg is just completely crippled, and you see both beast and rider sort of, like, shift off to the side. And you see the rider, who's all cloaked in white at this point, sort of does this athletic maneuver to move off of the thing. So they sort of throw themselves off to the side and maintain their footing as they're going. And at the same time, this figure manages to draw two long swords that were strapped to the side of the warg in this very deft, very military-minded maneuver that even you feel a little bit impressed by.
I'm going to use my bonus action, though, to fling the other axe right at the rider.
Okay. Please do.
I will. What? I got a 22.
Oh, shit. All right. So your hand axe flies true and manages to sink into, like, the very edge of the shoulder of this this figure. And then you see the red begin to bleed through the completely white linen robes of this individual, and it just sort of drips down in this very garish, like, stark contrast to the white and silver all around you. And this figure moves and turns its hood up towards you. And you see there, instead of a set of eyes like the others seem to have, it's this weird silver and black carved obsidian. It's almost like these demonic eyebrow sort of things turn towards you, and you can't see past the shadows of the deep mask as it turns.
A little weirded out.
Mm-hmm.
And I got 7 damage.
Yes. The figure in front of you doesn't seem to mind too terribly, but you feel this sense of, like, total ookiness as this gaze casts upon you. Despite the light and the brightness and the sun, there is no indication behind the eye holes that there is any actual, I don't know, flesh or face to be seen.
Some kind of weird demon or some shit, I don't know.
Yeah. And then we're gonna jump so over to now the raiding party.
Where'd Nassim go?
We've lost a Nassim.
Oh no!
Nana.
Nana.
And a special shout out to our friend Medinas, David Medinas, who drew fantastic character portraits
of all of us. Thank you so much. They were so cool.
I made my profile picture on Facebook.
Wait, I haven't seen yours yet. I haven't seen Kara's yet.
Oh my god, it's cool as hell.
What the hell? I've only seen mine and Sawyer's. And by the way, that's Arnadel's looking good. Thanks.
They're all babes.
Saya's got like incredible hair. That hair. Let me see. Oh shit! Oh my god!
Looks so good. Yeah, David Medinas. Damn, I think we're saying that right, but like, you're awesome. Thank you so much.
It kind of you're the coolest. It kind of made our days.
And by you made my week. Like,
and by kind of, yeah. I mean like, holy fuck! Like, that was
absolutely.
Yeah. That was cool. That was so cool. Like, special. That's special. And
I think having fan art like of your show is the most rewarding thing I can imagine.
Oh man,
needs to get like a ribbon. He's the first. We've got the first person that made fan art, and that's fucking special. And honestly, that shit, I'm like, oh, I don't know if anybody can do better. Like, that's
pretty cool. Like, I love the 8-bit like kind of style. Yeah. It's like, that's perfect.
You guys can hear me now?
Yes, we can see and hear you.
You're good.
We're just talking about our sweet, sweet fucking fan art.
Actually, I'm going to run real quick.
Okay. I would love to see like a video game with those as like the characters you can play as. Honestly, like, I hear like the music, do 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 do, just like that.
You're right back too.
Precisely.
Oh, breaky break. I guess it's like intermission right now. Sage, by the way, your hair is looking great. That's amazing.
Thanks.
I saw it on Facebook, but it's like, I can't even, like, I was going to say, like, it's better in person, but, like, we're still on a screen.
It's better on webcam.
It's better on webcam. It's better, like, moving. And then the no baby thing.
I'm glad that tickled you so.
Yes. I would say that would probably work better for a male. Like, if I get kicked between the legs, like, it's gonna hurt because I just got kicked, but I know it's not gonna, of course, yeah. It's not the same as, like, getting kicked if you have two huevos down there. Like, I've heard of Seriously. Guys, like, vomiting and, like,
oh, yeah, like, I've definitely seen that.
Like, truly being incapacitated, and then, like, oh, you've been kicked in the balls. I'm like, have you ever got an IUD? Because that shit hurts. Like, seriously, though. That shit sucked. Are you part of that club? I know Celeste is.
Which club?
The IUD club.
Oh, no. Oh, God, no.
It's... There was, like, okay, on Snapchat, you know how there's different things you can subscribe to? Like, there's Vice, there's National Geographic, whatever, and they have, like, little Snapchat stories. Well, there was one, I don't remember who created it, but it was, like, the IUD, I think it was BuzzFeed. The IUD sisterhood, like, once you get an ID, you're part of this, like, explicit club, what's the word I'm looking for? Whatever, you know, I'm sure you can remember.
It'd be explicit.
Yeah, you're part of this, like, unique club, and man, it's, yeah, you definitely can high five on that shit, because.
No, man, I'm just going to get a tubal ligation.
Really? You don't want to have kids at all?
Nope.
You're like, fuck that shit.
Being a nanny has been the best birth control.
Yeah, I can imagine. Well, no, I can't imagine, but I can kind of imagine. There's, like, somebody that lives not even in the same building as us. Like, they're, like, across the street, and I can hear their child screaming at random hours, and I'm just like, I know people say it's different when it's your own kid, but I'm just like, I like playing video games for, like, 10 hours straight, and...
Right, obviously.
So... Yeah, kids don't
fit. All big sacrifices.
Yeah, kids don't fit in that equation. We're talking about IUDs and having babies.
Oh, love IUDs. Don't love babies. I mean, I love babies when they're other people's.
I don't even like other people's babies. I'm going to be real. I like my godson, and that's literally.
Oh, my God. I'm sorry. I forgot my drink in the kitchen. God damn it. I'll be so back. Wait, prepare for next round of combat.
Guys, we gotta come up with a plan.
You know what's really shitty? I, like, suddenly kind of have to
plan
now.
To... Just go.
No, I'll wait. I'll hold it. I'll go at a really inopportune moment. Yeah, what is the plan? What's going on?
I don't even know if I see you guys. If I'm near any of you.
You're like, falling off of a wing, right?
Yeah, I'm somewhere to the side of it.
We might be near each other.
Well, if you were on the bird, Saya, the same, you would be closest to me, probably, because I'm in the center/middle. Right? Aren't you on the out?
I think Celeste said that she got rolled out to the outer circle.
Really?
That's a big-ass wings.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah.
We're okay now.
Possible.
I'm back. I have whiskey.
Can you remind us, like, where we are in reference to...
Yes, okay. So if you're looking at... So imagine a north by south, west by east. So if west is to your left and east is to your right on whatever situation. So Kara, you are on the far outside ring on the far south. Arnadel and Aaron, you are exactly in the second ring directly north of Kara.
Okay.
The rock is right there in the middle. And then Sawyer, you are now directly north of the rock on the inner ring.
Oh. We're not by
Since you rolled far across. No.
How much space is it? Like, how many feet in diameter are these rings from each other? Like, what would be the radius difference?
So The rock itself, so the center circle, is solidly a 30 by 30 foot monster.
Okay.
So huge.
Okay, so 15 foot radius.
It's a very
big critter.
Far amount of distance in between you and Saye right now.
Yeah.
And then each ring itself would be about 10 feet.
Oh, okay, that's all right. That's, like, I could yell
so at... So it's a very tight circle.
Yeah, I could yell at Kara if I needed to.
Yeah.
Yeah, you and Kara could definitely... You're in visual range, and you're also within yelling range.
Okay.
But it would be with the commotion, it would be... You would have to scream at the top of your lungs to talk to her.
Gotcha.
There's or almost no chance of Saye.
Okay, yeah, my awakened mind, I just have to make sure... Let me check to make sure what the range is on that. I think it's, like, either 30 or 60.
I think it's 30. Yeah.
I think it's 32, but I'm going to also double check, just because I love looking at this book.
Books are nice.
We talked about this before we signed on. Like, how many of you fair listeners, when you get a new book, like to smell the pages? That sounds so creepy.
Oh my god, it's so real.
Yeah, but for real, like, I love smelling the pages.
Well, like, I posted a thing like, oh, I'm waiting for my copy of Yawning Portal. They're like, well, you know, if you have, you know, roll 20, you can just look it up. I'm like, but I can't. Like, I can't. I have to hold it in my hands.
You gotta feel the pages.
To experience it. Tactilely experience it.
For sure.
So another description I was waiting on until we were all back. So everybody's surrounded in these rings. You know, you have the two kind of wargs and the riders on the outside. So now these folks in the center of the circle are beginning to break and move off. So clearly they've recognized that things are not going their way, and they are trying to run off as quickly as possible now. So actually on their turn, which is right now, all of the footmen are going to be running off 30 feet in all directions as a general breaking. So what's happening now is you all are in this general position, right? Kind of positioned around the rock. And then the footmen are just breaking off to follow the two warg leaders, who one is posted to the northeast and one is posted to the southwest. So, okay. Kara, the one you just hit is to the southwest.
Okay.
And then the other one's to the northeast on two very separate sides of this large circle. So three footmen are now to the northeast, and three are running to the northwest. The northwest is the rider who's wearing this freaky, weird mask. I'm sorry, the southwest.
Yeah.
Southwest.
Who it sounds like seems pretty
southwest.
Unperturbed by your, by all of this.
By who?
The rider that's freaky deaky.
Yeah. You can't see facial expressions at all, so you have no way of determining how much or how little this rider is disturbed. Alright. The rock. So that's the rock's turn. So basically it takes its great giant wingspan and just begins to drift up and up. And it's incurred a few injuries, like damages to its general wings as it's going, but that doesn't seem to stop this great beast as it just carries on up into the sky, now suddenly free with this newly given vigor and as it's floating up. So I'm actually going to need you all in the middle ring to make dexterity saves for me, just from the force of this thing's wings trying to push you back. So that's going to be Saye, Arnadel, and Aaron.
I don't know what I did with my dice. So dexterity saves?
So Kara, you're just far enough away that you don't have to make this.
Oh, yeah.
Dexterity, yeah. The wind is just...
I rolled a 9.
...pushing you.
I got a 13.
Okay. So you actually both get pushed back 5 feet, so you're pushed back towards the outer ring as this thing's wings are just going to town and dust is flipping up and it's hard to see and it's just a whole clusterfuck as this giant bird is taking off into the sky. But you manage to keep your footing. As does Aaron. Moving back and through. Alright, Arnadelle.
Eldritch Blast. Or, sorry, not Eldritch Blast. Witch Bolt. Yeah.
Oh my god, that's the stream. Yeah.
Bless you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Alright, so you don't have to make any rolls, you just roll again for damage.
Three damage.
This guy is just like running out there. He's like, why are you hitting me? And is like running off into the desert. Like, stop it! Encased in this green and like black blue light as he's running away. It's very sad.
Does he say that in common?
Yeah, no, in common he's like, why? Ow! Like, he jumps, one of those Cartoon Network things, he jumps, like, 2 feet up in the air as he's zapping.
Does he grab his butt, like, when he runs?
Yes, exactly. It's like, that was not cool.
Beautiful.
Just, like, running off. He's dropped his spear completely. A lot of these footmen seem to be just totally, like, abandoning the cause now that you've killed over half their party. And this creature is clearly getting away, and they had no idea this was going to happen.
Aha!
It seems like bad luck. Wrong place, wrong time for these guys.
Yeah.
Sawyer.
I want to run north, keep going north towards the outer rider.
Yeah. So they're all kind of drifting towards the northeast now, so you could totally make like a 30-foot move towards them and be within 10 feet of anyone.
Okay. I do that. And I want to get up as close as I can to the rider and do a stunning strike.
So you could get one of the footmen, but the rider is just a little bit outside of your range.
Oh, okay.
So it's like the footmen are all kind of flanking around the rider trying to like, what do we do? Like, what do we do, boss? It's kind of the general feeling you're getting. So you could definitely ride up to one of them, or run up to one of them and rock them.
Wait, so everyone is now left basically the center where the rock has just taken off and they're all, this circle's expanding.
Yes.
Then I take that back. I want to run the other way. I want to run towards the center of that now larger circle.
So the way things are happening right now, you just got pushed back away from the center because the rock was, like, taking off and moving. So yeah. Still, like, the wind and the dust and everything would give you a really hard time to move towards the center. So I would need you to make at least a dexterity or a constitution to get towards. So imagine this bird is still, because this is all happening in the same 6 seconds, right? This giant bird is just, like, taking off and sending this column of, like, air and force down towards the center.
I thought he had already taken off.
6 seconds. Not a long time. In the press. Yeah.
Alright, I'll make a dex save.
Sure, to run to the center.
Yeah. That's 16.
Okay, yeah, so you kind of like bob and weave your way through the natural like columns of dust and smoke that are being conjured up by this creature, sort of like duck and roll and land yourself like in the center directly underneath the great bird. So now you're standing, it's actually this huge shadow is cast upon the ground, like where this creature is taking off, because it is the largest form of shade or shape in this entire place. So you feel a little bit colder as you're standing underneath this great shadow.
Way to work on your airbending skills.
Yeah. Hope it doesn't crap.
Oh, God.
Make a constitution save.
No, I'm going to stay put until it takes off.
Mm-hmm. So probably another full round, and it'll be, like, at least 30 feet up in the air. So right now it's hovering. It's about 15 feet up.
Okay.
But with its injuries, it took a little bit of time to get its just massive body weight moving.
All right. Can I see now from where I am where the other two are, or is it still too dusty?
No, you can see now. So everything now, you're in the very, very center of the ring. So everything that's happening is 20 feet away from you at the forest. So Kara is 20 feet away from you. Aaron and Arnadelle are 10 feet away from you. The riders on the far side are at the outer ring, 20 feet away. The riders on the southwest, 20 feet away. The riders on the northeast, 20 feet away. Sorry. Just the two riders. Your Arnadelle and Aaron directly to the south, 10 feet away. Kara to the southwest, 20 feet away.
Got it.
Okay. I want to try to shout to Arnadelle, since she's close and probably listening. We should run back to the hut thing, the igloo.
Do you want me to roll a perception check, or do you want me to wait till my
turn? No, you can hear it.
Okay.
Because she ran into the center of everything, so now you're about 10 feet away from each other.
Ah, okay. Okay, so I'll... do I have to wait till it's my turn to do...
You can yell back. Well, Simple conversation.
Awaken mind.
Yeah, sure, you can do that. Consider it like a free talking action. Yeah,
I think so. And it's 30 feet. Are Kara and Valerius within 30 feet?
Yes. So everybody now that Saya has moved to the center is kind of on that southern corridor of the fight, so you can hit everyone in this.
And the igloo is still up. Like that.
Yes, it's about 30 feet to the west of the outside rim.
Okay. So awaken mine. Everybody get back to the igloo! Egg. Right now!
Okay. And no one can respond to you, as we've determined.
Yeah. Correct, yes.
But Aaron looks over at you and he's like, since you took one of his daggers, he's got one in his hand, and he's like, cool. Like, thumbs up, babe.
What?
I don't know. And then just starts running. We didn't talk about that.
Everything needs a cut name. Aw, he called me babe. That's sweet.
Give him a babe.
Yeah, and so Valerius at this point has just been sort of stampering around the outside edges.
Stampering?
And, well, because he's on top of the horse, who was left over from the cart that you had blocked in the igloo. So he's, like, moving back and forth on the horse as he's been this whole time.
So pacing?
And he's been clearly, like, casting spells, though, like, it's obviously, like, nothing you've seen or,
doing
like...
something?
He's stampering. Something.
He's been stampering.
He's stampering back and forth on the horse. Oh, and, yeah. Making hand signals that look real wizardy.
Valerius, it's time for dressage later.
I don't know what that means.
What?
Is it a salad dressing? That sounds fantastic.
It's horse dancing.
Oh. No. What?
We're in
danger! And then he suddenly looks away from me and is like, I don't want to continue this conversation.
I am impressed with your horse knowledge.
Yeah, Valerius has been doing something, clearly not helping out the main combat, but he turns tail on his horse and then starts heading back. And, Kara.
I'm squared off with this dude, so I'm gonna keep fighting him.
This dude is still about 10 feet away from you.
That's perfect.
So he hasn't, like, come running towards you, and you haven't moved towards him. It's just been kind of this cold
stand.
fastest guns in the tumble. West.
Assault covered tumbleweed rolls past.
A cactus gleams in the distance.
I am backing down from a fight, and I don't like the cut of his jib, even though precisely because I can't see it, so I can't judge its worthiness. So I am gonna keep fighting this dude because
is this like some Witch King shit.
God, I hope not. If it is, I'm about to get in some real trouble.
I hope you're like.
Yeah, she's gonna.
I hope you're like.
Come at him with his with her battle axe. I'm a charging my laser.
Excellente.
I got an 18.
Does not hit the armor.
No!
18?
So as you run and do like an upswing with your battle axe, like charging towards this individual who's been unseated from the warg, right? And then three of the footmen are kind of clustered around his warg on the far side of you, like, waiting for further instruction. They almost seem to turn towards you with this slow awareness. Almost as if they aren't concerned, necessarily. And the strike of your axe rings true and sinks deeply into the armor of whatever this individual is wearing, like cutting across between their hip and their chest piece. And you see the black sort of ceramic mask move down and calmly observe your strike. And then two gauntleted hands sort of grip the edges of your axe and shove it out and backwards, like, out of their own chest cavity. And I will need you to make a constitution save for me.
Oh my god.
Very well. Then I'm gonna use my bonus action to chop him again. What? Natural 20!
Whoa! Alright, so you see as this figure, like, shoves the axe backwards towards you, your blade becomes encased in this burning... this burning... Yeah, I know, Nassim.
For everybody who's but listening, it's Nassim. We keep losing Nassim.
Nassim! But, this is actually important for Nassim to hear.
I know, This is intense.
You know.
This is
intense. You feel me?
Yeah, I feel it.
Oh, man.
So I keep, ants keep showing up on this wall next to me.
That's great.
And I literally have no choice but to kill them.
No, don't kill them. Don't kill them. They're just little baby ants. They don't do anything. They just stay. They literally just stay in their lines. It's not like
They go and tell their friends to come back.
I know, but
and then there's a lot of them.
I don't ever have problems with ants in the house. I'm like, you know what? It's not like you're a nasty little cockroach or a little spider. And even those I don't kill, I still free outside.
Oh my god! I was walking to the store. I was walking in the store today, and this bug that was, like, an inch and a half long just, like, flew onto me. It was, like, brown and long, so it wasn't like a cockroach, but it kind of looked like a skinny cockroach. And I just freaked out in the middle of the street. I was carrying a package, and I just, like, threw it down. I'm just like, ah!
Was it a grasshopper?
No, it was not a grasshopper. It, like, looked like a beetle of some kind.
Oh man, you know what bugs I really hate? I hate June bugs. They can go fuck themselves.
Aww, they're so...
I love June bugs.
No. They're hideous!
That's a huge... No, they're not. They're not as ugly as cicadas. Cicadas are ugly.
What are those, the harvest bugs? The ones that are huge?
Locusts?
Or potato bugs?
Potato bugs are, and June bugs are the same thing.
No, okay, I don't know what kind of...
I saw one in my backyard and I just died.
I don't know what kind of freaky California shit you guys are up to, but potato bugs are also known as roly-polies, which are not insects, they're crustaceans.
No.
What? No, that is not right.
No. Yes, potato bugs are like these bulbous headed, like huge.
No.
At least an inch long creatures.
This is where it's a regional dialect thing because.
Nope.
A handful of places that I've lived, I'm a military brat for anybody who's.
Okay, you know what? I'm fucking looking at it on Wikipedia. Will you accept Wikipedia?
No, because that's written here in California. No. I've grown up knowing either roly-polies has always been synonymous with potato bug or sow bug.
Look at this. Look at this bullshit.
That's a potato bug. Fuck
that's a potato bug.
Fucking the hell.
It's also called a Jerusalem cricket. It's also called a June bug. They're fucking.
What?
They're about this long and they crawl out of the ground.
They're vile.
I've never seen the scariest.
They're disgusting.
I hate them so much.
I
just remember being a kid hearing somebody call a roly-poly also a potato bug or a sow bug or a doodle bug. I've never seen that shit, though. What, you freaky California people? Weird-ass farming animals? Probably.
Weird-ass farming bugs?
There she is.
Yay!
Hello! Are you back? She can see us.
Can you hear us?
There's so many problems. I'm sorry, guys.
Oh.
Yeah, I see you.
We were just... It's okay. The
internet just decides to turn itself off.
Oh. Do you have AT&T?
Talking about breast bugs.
They just changed it to... I think it's that, or...
Okay.
Might have been...
I hope I don't get, in trouble for saying this, but fuck AT&T. I hate that internet. They...
I don't know what it is.
Capitalist structures are evil.
Yeah.
Yay. Anarcho-realism.
This is the third time I've recorded from home, too, and this is the first time I've had so many issues.
It's okay. You only missed us talking about, local vernacular and
different kinds of bugs that we hate.
I've never seen that.
Anyway.
It looks, nightmarish.
It's the shit of... Yeah. Anyway. Where were we?
Yeah, and then I made my natural 20 con save.
Yes. So as this writer had, the masked writer had gotten off their warg and then, had taken this just giant axe blow without any seeming consequence or anything, and then shoved it back in your direction. No!
God damn it!
The seam!
What?
Technical difficulties.
Can you just do it and then we'll fill her in?
Yeah. So... Okay. She says maybe she has to stop with the video and just mic. That'd be fine.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Video eats up so much broadband. Broadband? Upload? Whatever that... Yeah. It eats up a lot. I literally put an ice... You guys want to hear some ghetto shit right here? I literally put an ice pack underneath my computer. Whilst live streaming, because... No, why buy a fan?
That shit gets
just
hot.
Use an ice pack. Because it's working! It's not hot anymore!
Dude, do you guys mind playing...
Jet engine.
You guys mind playing a little late...
No, not at all.
Tonight?
I love playing.
Fine.
I live for this shit. I live for it. I'm already through my 22-ounce, 9.2% beer, and I'm on to a bottle of wine. We'll see how it... Let's see.
I'm just like, yeah, I need another drink.
Yeah. For those of you wondering which drink I'm drinking, it is the Lagunitas Imperial Stout.
That's your one, boo-boo. That's your signature.
You know why?
Can I
tell you? Well, yes, the Imperial Stout. Anything above...
Hang on. No, wait. You can't tell me. I gotta refill. Yeah.
Hurry up. Okay, I want to tell this story about...
Our audience.
Okay, I'll tell the audience. Sage, I'm gonna share this with you, especially because you've been playing Dragon Age Inquisition.
Okay.
Before I moved in... 2014. No, it would have been beginning of 2015. I started using Saucy when I lived in San Francisco. And I used Saucy every damn night. Every night. Because
it
was before...
I recall.
It was before they jacked the living fuck up out of their prices, and it used to only be, a $2 delivery fee, and that was it, and, like, they didn't, price gouge the thing. This is normally $5 goddamn dollars at Safeway, Vons, or whatever the fuck, wherever it is, HEB, King Supers, wherever it is in the country you are.
Yeah.
And, but this was the only Imperial Stout that, Saucy had. So I got into the habit of drinking this one every night while I played Dragon Age Inquisition. The moment that I got home from work, I would order Saucy while I was still on the bus home because I knew how long it would take. And I'd order that shit. I'd get home. The delivery person would be waiting there. I'd thank you very much. Here's the tip. Go inside, sit my ass down and play Dragon Age Inquisition for hours and hours and hours. And that is the story as to how I fell in love with Lagunitas Imperial Stout. And it's $5, and it delivers every time. It's a good beer. Some people don't like it, but they can fuck off. This beer's delicious. It's my everything. So is Yeti, Great Divide Yeti. Oh, God, that's a good fucking stout. All right,
hello.
We got you back?
There we are.
Yay.
All right.
Missy, cool. You're signing... picture's really cute.
It's awesome.
It's thanks.
Cute. You and your Chargers looking silly.
Is it Chargers?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a Chargers jersey. Boo. Look, I know sports.
I don't know sports. You know
why? I did sports.
You know why I know about the Chargers? It's not because I live in San Diego, but because there were a bunch of tattoo cover-up memes that were circulating.
Because they're moving to L.A. Boo! Anyway.
Everyone's fucking moving around right now. It's all bullshit.
I know. My two teams, the Chargers and the Raiders, they're all leaving me. That's fine.
Well, I didn't know you liked sports. I had no idea you liked
sports. The only man I can trust is Gary Gygax. Let's be real.
Opposite of sports.
Yeah. Anyway, Nassim, can you turn up your mic a little bit?
Turn up?
Yeah. You're very quiet.
You sound fine to me.
All right. And make sure your Audacity is still recording after logins and logouts.
It is Audacity.
Okay. And do you mind going a little bit late since we had tech delays?
Sure.
Rad. All right. All right, we're back. So, Kara, you had sunk your axe into this individual. They had not seemed to care, and then these dancing flames had sort of moved up the blade and ends of the axe moving towards you, and they were this black and red sort of stream, but you seemed to... Yes, Brittany, you're raising your hand.
You didn't explain that. You waited until she got back. You didn't explain any flames bursting out. Where did that come from?
Yeah, that's what the Constitution was. So suddenly, your axe becomes encased in this sickening, strange red, black, orange combination of flames that, dart through everything. So it's basically the Constitution was, you trying to maintain a grip on your weapon as this happened. Whatever it had pulled off of you had receded back onto the blade, and some kind of spell had been cast to repel you. But you managed to shake off, so your hands become hot and, feel acidy and weird, as you're trying to maintain, but you push through it. And keep a grip on your blade for your bonus action.
Swing at him again!
That's some shit. Do we see
it's
this?
It's a 15.
You would see the burst of flames coming off. But both Saye and Arnadel, you're too far away to get specifics on this.
One of our listeners says, I think I know what this might be.
Oh. I don't know.
That's awesome. What? I have no fucking idea.
I don't know either. I'm just the DM.
Oh my God.
go ahead and... So a 15 does not hit.
Sadness.
So your blow comes clanging and bouncing off of this armor. So this opponent was dressed in the white robes, you know, of desert travel beyond that, but you have clearly, like, this thing is decked in full armor underneath this layer. And the orange and red fire just sort of, like, threw your guard off and just kind of misguided your blow as you were going in there, and you aren't able to land a solid hit.
Shoot.
All right. And then moving onwards. So the barbarians, so now to the southeast, this group, now that it's totally, like, unmolested by you guys, just begins to book it off across the desert. So this warg rider is making their way out, and the three footmen are just charging to the best of their ability behind this creature as they're going and trying to get out of dodge before this rock makes its final assault.
That makes me wonder if these people know about the creature that attacked Kara. Because, like, if you knew that your fellow attacker was, like, powerful like that or had something like that up their sleeve, I feel like they would probably be like, fuckers, like, look what we got on our team. But they're running.
So I think he is their leader.
So there are three of the footmen still standing by the opponent Kara squaring off against.
Okay, gotcha.
There was no more information collected on the warg rider to the northeast. And three footmen also followed that individual. Okay. So there's nothing to say what it could be, or no specific details on what the rider looked like. As they're darting off to the northeast now. But clearly the fight is lost, and they're booking it. So at this moment, the rock... So, Sawyer, you begin to feel, like, as the rock reaches a grander zenith, that's what it's been, like, sort of doing and summoning its courage and energy to move up and towards. You see this great beast, just the shadow of this thing, rise and move over the desert as it goes and descends directly upon that warg rider who you saw before. And you see this great beak move and snap this warg and rider in unison together and carry it upwards in its jaws. And as it does so, with its two great talons below, it picks up two of the footmen in one deft move and takes up and towards the sky, drifting now and moving far beyond the reaches you could have thought possible. And as you go and pay it, you know, general attention to it, you hear in the distance a scream of just,
oh, whoa.
As this happens off in the distance as the rock takes its revenge.
Rock's beautiful. Not hungry anymore. Again, Arnadel screams again, get to the egg!
Yeah, you get have a temporary egg. Alliance.
You're gonna have to drag me away from this motherfucker, because they know I'm not leaving.
Should I witch bolt you? I mean, Eldritch blast you?
It's Arnadel's turn. Aaron is also standing beside you. He's like, I don't know what to do.
I put my hand on I pinch his lips together, and I'm like, egg! Get to the egg! And then I'm going
just
to...
Just an NPC.
Oh my god. She's so bossy.
He is asking too many goddamn fucking questions. Just move! Ask questions
just
later!
Do what I said! Hey!
Okay. He loves passive aggressive.
That was just aggressive
relationships. He loves strong and charged women.
I'm gonna give a loving. Can we do a little bit of role playing where Arnadel feels like she knows just the right amount of magical energy to use to snap Kara out of her rage so that she can kind of get with it. I'm not attacking her. Like, it's just the right amount of energy So that card does not feel attacked.
Keeps going.
It's like, hey, like, snap out of it. Like, type zap.
It's between you two.
All right, Kara. What do you want? What do you want from me? What do you need?
What do you will physically have to drag me away, because if I take damage, that prolongs the rage.
All right.
How long does this rage last for?
It lasts for a minute. Or until I am unconscious.
Isn't a minute one round?
No, that's 10 rounds.
Ten rounds. And we're not
a round is 6 seconds.
All right, so my turn.
Never mind.
I'm how far away? How many feet away am I from Kara?
So you're right now about, we can call it 10 feet.
All right, I'm gonna run over to Kara. I'm gonna get right in her face, in front of her. I'm gonna grab her like this, and I'm gonna be like, okay, for those of you can't see, I'm like shaking my hand. Like,
take it around.
Yeah, you like
take grab your cheeks. Grab your cheeks.
You put your hands on somebody's face, and you're just like, not in a mean way, just like, woman. Like if they're, you know, like your like, your friend is like way Oscar too wasted.
Oscar winning moment. I'm grabbing your face, and we're gonna have a dramatic dialogue.
Dramatic dialogue, and the dialogue is, Arnadel says, "What do I say?" Of course,
let me tell you, it's dramatic.
Kara! What do you do?
What is it, Arnie?
Come with me, if you want to live!
God damn it.
Oscar, and I shout, get down! Get into the igloo!
Get to the igloo! Thank you.
This is so dumb.
I know. I can't believe that's where it went.
Kara,
what do you do?
I don't know. Do you want to receive this? If you want, like, you can make a.
Can we roll?
Ah, fuck. I don't know. Make a roll wisdom. A persuasion versus a.
Goddamn stubborn roll.
Yeah, like what would that be? Like a. Constitution, maybe? Because that's, like, what's inspiring you.
Yeah,
I think Constitution sense. Versus...
My Persuasion.
Persuasion would be good.
Well, I got a 5, so...
Okay.
I think you win.
I literally got a 21 on Persuasion, so...
I'm persuaded. I'm reluctant, but okay.
You went from green to normal.
Yeah, exactly.
Alright, so as you're having that moment, and Kara's brought out of her rage, Sawyer, it's actually your turn.
Now I'm trying to help them, going towards them and help them all get into the igloo as well. The egg.
Can you make a perception check for me, please?
That's... Perception. 22.
Okay. So as you're running by, like, Kara and Arnadel have this moment where they're, like, grabbing each other's faces, like, in the middle of this combat, and Valerius is bolting past on a horse, and Aaron is running by trying to be like, guys, we don't have time! And, like, move through. And in the midst of all this chaos, it's almost like your vision seems to singularly focus. And turn its attention to this figure who's standing in front of your companions. And suddenly you recognize everything. That mask that's waiting under the white hood, you know it. You've seen it before.
No.
And the fear and the panic rises as in your chest as you just know intricately. That was the face of the thing that killed your mother.
Shut up!
Moving through. Oh my God. And you only have a moment to comprehend that as, like, you have to run past and move through, just like blasting through like the sands and the heat and everything, and you're not sure what it was, or but like everything, the situation, that's the one thing that's clear to you, is that your fucking enemy is standing 20 feet away from you at this very moment. And all you can do is keep running.
I didn't. Whoa.
That's all I want to do? I just run, like, run away?
That's in the middle of what you're doing. You're you not just encountered
ready
that.
Yet. You're not ready.
So you are paused. You've been running now for 30 feet. You have a standard action. If you want to keep running, you can. Towards the igloo, you're still about 30 feet away. It would take the rest of your round. Or you can make a standard action.
Oh, I can't. Oh, I don't know. I'm frozen.
Mm-hmm. Also valid if you want to try, if you want need to hold your action.
I think she would be. I think she would just be stuck.
Yeah.
She's very confused as to what to do right now.
Okay, so as that happens, and you kind of, like, hold, you hear, you don't even actually hear, it's all coming from this weird tunnel place where you're so focused on what's going on, it's like the real world becomes a blur for you for a moment, and then you hear the distant clattering of hooves behind you, and you feel a hand reach out to you on the back of your robe. Like, and just pull you up and towards a horse, like,
oh, fuck!
We need to, Bo, we don't have time to be doing this. Come on, sightseeing for later.
The same god!
And you feel a big strength pulling you up onto the back of the horse as Valerius charges through and just seems to, like, force you onto the back of the horse with a strength, like, even beyond him as you're just booking your way towards this igloo. And he carries you on horseback, and you make your way generally inside, to that place. And, Kara, before you have a chance to react, the last thing you see is, like, your monk companion just sort of freeze. In a way she's never done. She's always been so reactive and so ready for combat, you know, this is just a completely odd opportunity before Valerius rushes in, just pauses dead in the middle of everything, and gets swept up. And you saw just right before, like, you were able to process this figure was moving towards her at this great speed and distance with this just his sharp, like, scimitar blade drawn as he was moving forward for the killing blow. And then Valerius scooped her at the last minute. But as this figure watches the two of them go, this black sort of shimmering powder seemed to descend from the pommel of his hilt. And this huge flash of black smoke smog seemed to encompass himself and the three footmen that were around him. So as you run up or try to make your strike for that blow, but everything is gone. Those three are gone. And then the rock has decimated the crew to the northeast. And now all you can see left of this battle are the bodies around you and the salt flats and this giant beast floating off into the sky. And that's the end of combat. Not the end of the game, because we owe you about another 15 minutes.
Did you get from that? Because I noticed we lost you right after you made that realization. Ooh. I gotta check in.
What do you mean, what did I make of that?
Did you miss anything important? Do you feel like you missed anything important?
No. Okay. No. I got it all.
Okay. I noticed that Skype went out for a minute.
It went out just when she was saying that I was getting swept up by Valerius. But that was it.
Okay. So, did Valerius, pick her up and did Valerius put her on the horse with him?
On the back of the horse.
He's strong.
With a strength uncommon. You think there might have been some magic involved there. Strength of the bearer. something. But basically, this figure, after not being able to strike you with the edge of his blade, which they certainly tried to do, basically dissipated by throwing a smoke cloud around themselves and the 3 foot soldiers around them, bringing us to the end of combat.
Yeah. Heavy. Did we end up getting back to the igloo? Were we just kind of like stopped?
Do we get the sense that the rock isn't returning? It's now pleased with its catch?
Yeah, definitely the rock. So after taking the 2 foot men, dropping them to their death, and then also taking Warg and the rider. So you actually, if you want to track it for about 5 minutes, do y'all want to stay and do that?
Yeah. Well, okay, let's vote. Yeah. Let's vote.
You have the igloo there, so it's earthen-shaped for you, so it's not going anywhere, the way the spell works.
I mean, I just want to, like, high-five this rock, like, hey, man, thanks for helping us out, like, please don't hunt us. Thanks.
So, at the end of the day, based on your general perceptions, like, you think the creature was smart enough to understand, like, who was its ally and who was its enemy. But, like, beyond that, trying to ask it diplomatic favors, and, I mean, it is a bird. It is bird brain. The noblest of all the bird brains.
I would imagine that one in particular probably wouldn't try to, like, I feel like it would recognize us, right? Like, if we continued on our journey and our journey lasted another like 3 days, that rock in particular wouldn't hunt us. That's all.
You get that sense. Yeah. Like if you hang out for a bit, you see it descends back down after a while and begins to eat the corpses of the individuals it dropped from a great height. And with a full belly, the rock moves off again into the desert, probably having the best day of meals it's had in a really long time after eating a horse and 2 fallen companions. And they'll probably come back for the carrion bodies in a couple weeks, because even the noblest of birds isn't beyond that. Right. And Valerius and Aaron, sort of after this whole ordeal, are like, well, we survived that! I mean, that's a pretty good sign that, I think things will go well for us in the future. I estimate we're only about 8 hours ride away from the fortress, if you are willing to go further for the day. I think it's in our best, interests to carry onwards.
I'm guessing the horse stayed inside of the igloo throughout that battle.
Valerius was riding the horse around.
Oh, okay.
During that battle.
Gotcha. That actually makes sense.
It is safe.
Yeah. Valerius, do you have any... I'm, like, exhausted. Do you have any spells that will help us along, or are we, like, gonna be walking along? We walk in this?
Yeah. We can ride in the court... in the cart. I believe if we hurry along, 8 hours shan't be a problem. If we've already interrupted a raiding party from the breach, I don't believe they will be sending another.
Alright, let's go.
Yeah, so you begin to make your way across the breach, and again, it's this horrible, desolate climate of these flat, long periods of ground interrupted barely by scraggly bushes or trees or anything. But eventually, over that next 8 hours, you make your way to the base of the mountain range that you've been seeing in the far distance this whole time. This mountain range that has, you know, across the peaks, this dusting of snow and icy ground, promising that somewhere beyond it you're moving into a sort of arctic climate. And you approach it eventually, like, moving up to the very base of the mountains. And as you approach this great scene. Valerius hops off of the cart now with this exhausted horse who's been pulling you for so long, but making it work and has been riding hard just to get through all of this. He walks forward and with his staff held aloft, kind of swings it to make these arcane symbols in the air. So this glowing blue light emerges, and this great doorway opens up in front of the mountainside. Welcome, one and all, to the Elysium Keep. You've made it here in one piece, and you all should be proud. And it was a bit of a rough ride.
I hear the Jurassic Park theme music playing in my head. That's what's happening.
I don't even know what that thing is. Sage, you're muted.
You missed my beautiful orientation. Kara's like, great, where's the ale?
Great. If you guys want to go till 10:30,
yes.
We're cool, but I really gotta pee.
Where's Nassim? She's been gone for like 10 minutes.
Yeah, she's having mad crap.
Oh, okay, whoa. Nassim's making a personal call. Hold on. This
is... I gotta pee so bad. Hang on, I'll be back.
Nassim, you are in a separate call. You need...
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
It's okay, let me... leave then.
Yeah, hang up and then let me invite you.
Yeah, that.
Sorry, Sage. Okay. Stand by. Let me invite Nassim.
Oh, by the way, David said you made beverage come out of his nose.
Us in general or anyone in particular?
You did when you grabbed Kara's face and you're like, get in the igloo.
What did I say? If you come with me if you want to live.
If you want to live. Yes. He said, damn it, Brittany, I just snorted my drink.
Don't get me wrong, I really like the Terminator movies, but, like, I don't know them that much to, like, I reference other shit way more readily than Terminator, so that's why I was like, that's where that's going, shit.
Alright, here we go.
Yay!
And,
you made it!
Excellent. Yeah. Oh, boy!
Okay, apparently it was happening, like, on the other side of the house, too, so, I don't know, something was just going on right now.
Like and I said!
We don't have anything.
Fucking AT&T. Get your shit together, AT&T. Literally, it's only two. Two different states that I've lived in and three different cities using AT&T, it has always had this problem where it just fucking shits.
Craps out, yeah.
Yeah, like once every 2 or 3 hours, it just takes a shit and you have to, like, it's really frustrating. I don't know what... Network engineers, please, can you riddle me this? Like, what the fuck's up with that? Oh, I gotta...
Are we taking another break because of me? I'm sorry.
No, I don't know why Celeste... Did she... What did she do?
I don't know.
Have you noticed, like, her... I know my screen looks different.
No? Yeah, no, she's... I just see her profile picture.
Yeah.
Hold on, let me add her. Because it says she's still there, but...
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. People are going to see this and be like, what's going on? Okay. Okay, let me hang up for her. She's going to hang up.
Sorry, everyone.
Okay.
Who's watching now.
All right, we're going to add Celeste.
Sage, your profile picture is, like, so dead on, and
symmetrical that I feel like you're staring at me, like, deep.
What happened?
Oh, we don't know, but we figured it out. Yay!
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah.
Epic pee-pee break.
No, I logged back in, but all of a sudden I couldn't see or hear anyone.
No.
Yeah, it was weird. I don't know.
Okay. Well, shit, guys.
Oh, boy.
We're in for the long haul now.
Okay.
Special bonus episode.
Yeah.
What did I miss?
Right, so after this fight, 8 hours have passed, basically, and you would come to the base of the mountain range, to the far north of this huge salt flat place you had been traveling, you had made way up.
Nobody searched the bodies?
If you would like to do that retroactively, you totally can.
Yeah, that's actually, you'll hear it when you're editing this, but that was actually what I was saying when the internet went out on me.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Before we move. Yeah, before we move on, I want to, like, snap out of my daze, hop off the horse, and just, like, frantically run through the remaining bodies of whatever men and women races are lying there.
Good call.
Find any... Oh, god damn it.
I'm way too shell-shocked to, like, do that, too. I'm just gonna watch you and be like, you got it. That's cool.
What is that? A survival?
Because investigation to search bodies.
Okay.
Kara takes a nap.
Yeah, I slumped down.
She sits sitting upright.
You know what? I sit next to you. I sit next, you know, like when you're sitting on the ground with your, like, knees up and your arms
back to
resting?
Back, yeah.
Yeah, we're going to do that. That way, like, Kara can rest. We can both kind of relax, right? Because you're, like, leaning on each other.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we do that. We have a moment.
So, Saye, as you're going through, so there are about 14 corpses here. So, Aaron also goes and kind of looks around with you, and Valerius is kind of doing a cursory glance on the horse as he's going. And every once in a while, he seems to stop for about 30 seconds and look really intently at something. And you get the sense that some kind of magic is going on there, or whatever. Mm-hmm. But as you're looking at the general bodies...
Magic.
Ew. We're doing that again?
Yeah.
Because it's the...
What the?
No, I'm
the microphone whisper?
No, I'm talking about...
The NPR talk?
Sexy talk.
No, I'm talking about, like, Eldritch Sight. Like, I would see this.
You're turning on detect magic. That's fine, but you recorded it like a barbarian, like whispering into your microphone again.
Is that the trait of a barbarian?
That's fine.
As a barbarian? No.
Or a sexual deviant. Or somebody that just has volume control, like problems. Anyway, what kind of magical shit's going on? I just noticed Valerius, and I'm going to be like, oh yeah, and I turn it on.
Wait, what did I find?
Yeah.
I'm getting to it,
sorry.
Hon.
Sorry.
All right.
Sorry, Nassim.
So as you're looking around, most of the gear, almost all of the gear that people are wearing are magical. So magical robes, magical hoods, magical face masks. And as you're going looking at them, not only are they very fine equipment for, like, outdoor... like hunting excursions or like camping excursions you would consider, but based on that too with the detect magic check, it's definitely got resistances placed on it, built specifically, so you think this entire party was outfitted, not only was it the same way, but it was also built to be like super trooper for dealing this kind of shit.
Yeah. You should take their shit.
And you should
let us know. I mean, they're also probably, like, riddled with blood and flesh now, because...
That's true, but it still doesn't diminish their finery and quality. So also, like, the ropes, for example, that you were looking at seem to have some kind of... I don't know, they're just the best ropes you've ever seen. Like, beyond elven silk, which is kind of the best you can buy for general, like, PHB shit... But these are like monster hunting ropes.
Yeah, you know? Whatever I can salvage, I will, but I don't seem to find any like uniform symbol or image or
what do their faces look like
on anything.
So it's actually a huge mishmash. So when you're actually looking at the faces and bodies of these individuals, it's a complete mix of men, women, different races, different cultures, like different markings, everything. It's just this complete hodgepodge, which is sort of unnerving in a way. It's like you don't necessarily know about any culture or society that would be so inclusive or to have so many representatives of them. So they don't have a general symbol or anything, but it's very clear that they were outfitted for a specific purpose. But it doesn't seem to be part of, like, a religious organization or a knight organization or anything of the sort.
Did you say they were all human? Or were you just looking at...
Oh, they're like, definitely not all human.
Okay, so different races.
Different races, completely. Different walks of life, even, in terms of ages, like, a whole hodgepodge of folks.
Wow. So with turning on Eldritch Sight, I can see that these garments are all magical.
All of the garments are magical, and then you see that the ropes themselves are magical, and the spears that were used by the footmen are magical.
I want one of those spears.
And then you see are two dead wargs in the circle, and both of their saddles are magical, and it's all enchantment.
Okay, magic. I'm going to, like, elbow Kara super hard and be like, Kara, this shit, get up. We gotta get this. It's magical.
Okay.
Sorry, wake up.
Oh, and I gotta get my hammers that I threw into those. Oh, I get the one out of the warg, I guess.
You might want to check out that saddle, too. The two saddles are magical, and spears and garments. So take your pick.
Okay. We could put the saddle on our horse, right? I'm gonna get a spear.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Alright, break.
Alright.
Shuffle off.
So if you grab garments, how many do you grab?
Go ahead.
I was gonna say, I would definitely like to grab one set of nice white linens to be much cooler in this arid heat. And yes,
you can find that off of a dead dwarven member of the raiding party. It becomes very clear to you. You're like, perfect.
Sweet.
I'm gonna grab two sets of clothing. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna grab three. I'm gonna give one to Aaron, and I'm going to give one to Valerius and just kind of like look at him. Nice. And I'm going to be like, hey, Valerius, things got kind of crazy back there and it was kind of shocking. And listen, I'm sorry if we got off on a wrong foot. I really appreciate all of the help and, you know, you're a good dude. And I like kind of clap him on the shoulder and I'm like, here, I don't know if you could use this, but peace offering?
Well, it's after Labor Day, darling, so of course I wouldn't be caught dead wearing white.
Isn't he wearing white robes?
Shut up, they're white pleather, it doesn't count.
Yeah, white pleather linen definitely doesn't count.
No, it doesn't! Oh my god! And he just sort of, like, throws his hand back. And kind of looks towards the ground.
I want to take this opportunity where I just put my hand up, and I'm like, listen, I speak the awkward language, too. It's okay. You don't have to say anything. Like, just, we're cool. I walk away.
Appreciate the gesture. All right. Well, okay, then we're done. All right. That's fine. Wonderful.
Valeria speaks the awkward language. It's okay. I get it now. I get it. We're on the...
No, what do you mean? I'm so good with people. They love me. All right. So after all that, any other business y'all would like to do before moving forward?
Yeah, finding out what the motherfucking AC and magical qualities are on all that armor, yo.
Okay, that'll be a later thing.
All right.
But if you want to move on, as we kind of did before into Seam.
Elysium, rolling.
Yeah, grab a saddle, put it on the horse, grab a spear, change of clothes.
Take a drink. Getting
ready to rock and roll. So the estimate is 6 to 8 hours to make it to your destination. So as you track on and alongwards, you're making your way closer and closer to this edge of mountain that you've seen off to the north. So you're running your way over these flats, just kind of booking it just in case you run into any other bands of raiders, anything, or strange large birds, just making your way there. And you come eventually to the base of the mountains, and Valerius holds his staff aloft, and with golden glow, he sort of holds it in front of him. And the mountain range, the base of these scrambly rocks and everything that just seems like a perfectly scenic view, seems to move down into the earth as if almost being carved from wax or cast to be this fake kind of scenic sunset thing as it goes down and the sun is like beaming its red gold light over the mountains. And he ushers you all to move in and forward. Well... congratulations, we've reached the Elysium Keep. I had my doubts that you would make it here alive, but here we are and here we stand. Are you ready to go forward?
Duh.
If there's ale on the other side.
What do you think?
Okay, no, let's go back, Cupcake.
That's where we'll end it, because we, you know, had to...
Because Valerius is pulling an Arnadel.
Pulling an Ani.
I have a sneaking suspicion we'll need to record more, because this episode was so short. But we'll figure it out, and it'll be great.
We did have so a lot many. Of, like, side jokes and, like, side conversations and...
All right.
It was good.
Well, thank you, everyone, so much for tuning in to episode 14 of the Venture Maidens podcast. I, of course, have been your Dungeon Master, Celeste Konowich.
And I have been your Elven Warlock Arnadel, played by Brittany.
And I tried to be your Human Monk, Saya, played by Nassim.
I tried so hard and fell so far.
But in the end, I had no fucking internet.
So good.
Womp womp. And I've been Kara, your barbarian friend.
Yeah, and a special thanks to everyone who tuned in for a bonus episode last week. I know it was kind of like a differentiation, but we're setting up our Patreon. We're setting up, like, bonus episodes for y'all to enjoy and kind of, like, take a break from the main story every once in a while, but, like, we love it, and we love you, and we're getting so much support, and thank you so much. And thank you again to David Medinas for doing those rad little images of all the characters. I love them so much.
Those are going to be
beautiful art.
Yeah, I want to upload those to our website as well as all of our social media pages, and we'll definitely send a shout like links to David's other artwork and his personal pages. Absolutely. And
fan art is like the dream. Like, it's so awesome, like, that's to like get that.
Fucking yeah, that is a huge, like, huge compliment. And I have to also say, I'm starting to understand how important it is to rate and motherfucking review. If you have a second, rate our podcast and review it.
Yeah, seriously, that's I know, like,
and thank you.
Yeah, the minute I, like, figured out, like, how horrible it is if you don't get enough ratings, you just, like, drop into obscurity on websites, and, like, it's so brutal if you don't get enough rate reviews. It's like, if just every person who listened, like, left a rating or review on any site, like, hey, we'd be so sad.
I want to challenge... Wait.
One word.
I am challenging listeners. Have you ever read, like, the gallon of milk review on Amazon? Or two wolves in a mountain. Here's the thing. Get on there and write the funniest shit you can imagine. Creative writing classes abound. Submit that in your get on there and get creative with your review for Venture Maidens. Who knows? We might use it for an episode. We might use it for a character.
I love creative bullshit. We love it here.
Yeah.
Have you not gotten that yet? What do we need to do to convince you?
I beg of ye, get on and write a creative
I ad. Doth beseech thee.
And make sure you put 5 stars in that. 5 stars with a really crazy ass review. Guess what? It may not have to have anything to do with Venture Maidens, but we'll read it. I want to get on there.
Seriously, doesn't. But 5. Yeah. Oh man. Thank you, everyone, so much for listening. We're gonna tune out for the night, but thank you, everyone. And you know what? Venture away.
Venture fucking away.
Yeah.
All right.
Venture fucking away. All day. Every day.
Done. Yeah, we've stopped streaming.
Ooh, that was rough, y'all.
It was.
We made it.